Graham Williamson, member of the Executive Board of Nations Without States, will join us now live from London to get his views on the abduction of the Kurdish leader Öcalan and on other issues. Thanks for speaking to Ronahi, Mr. Williamson. Today, the 15th of February, marked the 15th anniversary of the abduction of the Kurdish leader Öcalan. What is your take on this day?
Okay. First of all, thank you for welcoming me on the programme. So good afternoon to all your speakers and viewers. I don't know the specifics of any international conspiracy as such, but it stands to reason that there would be, since most states around the world oppose self-determination for fear of encouraging their own captive nations within their own territory. And the West, of course, has always taken a strong line against so-called armed struggle by branding all members of such as terrorists. So we shouldn't be surprised that there will be collaboration between the West and various people that oppose self-determination, so they would naturally work together behind the scenes. But that apart, clearly Turkey was driving this abduction, and it was an attempt to decapitate the Kurdish liberation movement, presumably hoping that Kurds would lose heart and desert the struggle. Yet despite that act, I would suggest that the movement has grown and Öcalan has outwitted his captors with his peace initiative. So if it intended to destroy the Kurdish movement, it failed miserably.
Mention that the scenes shown on Ronahi's screen are live from Strasbourg, where the rally is taking now place. Let's move on now, Mr. Williamson, to Rojava. Your organization, Nations Without States, issued a statement in support of the announced administrations of Rojava cantons. Tell us more about the reasons behind your support.
Well, Nations Without States is a pressure group, as you mentioned, and it supports the right of all peoples to self-determination. It stands to reason that we would support a nation looking to run its own affairs, such as Rojava. So clearly, that's why we support Rojava.
Countries always emphasize on the need to democratize the nations. Now that the people of Rojava are practicing democracy on the ground amid regional terrorism, why don't we witness any support from these countries, Mr. Williamson?
Well, as I said, because the world fears self-determination, and in the Middle East, of course, Arabs fear democracy, or some Arabs do anyway, leaders, and fundamentalists fear secularism, and have a reason not to support the Kurds, have a reason to suppress the Kurds. Mm-hmm. And I think this was a reason why Kurds weren't represented at the recent peace negotiation in Geneva too, because obviously they didn't want to recognise that the Kurds exist, recognise that there's a dynamic there which is actually a positive one, because I believe that it's positive because it gives Kurds obviously an identity, gives hopes that Kurds can struggle in Turkey and in Iran, of course, to get some form of autonomy at least. And of course, other peoples around the world, other captive nations, are looking to Rojava, as they looked to South Sudan earlier last year. They're looking to success, and the Kurds in Rojava in Syria are showing this success. And of course, because it's secular, it's democratic, it's decentralist, and other minorities are obviously protected and absorbed in that territory, this is fearful for other Middle East dictators.
Taking place in the East changed the Western stance toward the Kurdish issue. Can this ignorance turn into support?
I think it's possible, but of course, in the West at the moment, although they profess democracy and pluralism, they have other reasons not to support Rojava. For instance, economics, such as trade and oil, is obviously vital to the West. And at the bottom line is, whatever they say, they always put that first. So obviously, Arab countries that supply oil to the West, and countries that the West like to sell arms to, if they don't support the Kurdish struggle, the West sadly won't support it either. Mm-hmm. I think, however, ultimately, Rojava is a role model for the Middle East, and it is possible that we could see a turn where eventually the West decides that it will support that role model. Mm-hmm. It won't happen overnight, and of course, we believe that people power in the West needs to be mobilised to get the Western establishment to accept that Rojava, long-term, is the best solution.
Mm-hmm. Kurds are the world's largest nation without state. What distinguishes Kurds and their struggle from other nations without states and their struggle?
Well, I think the main reason is success, because Rojava has been created. And of course, you have southern Kurdistan as well in the last few years. So clearly, after struggling for many, many years, much longer than many nations have struggled for some form of identity, the Kurds have finally seen some sort of results. And of course, what's happening in Turkey, despite the fact that Turkey hasn't been very honest in the way it's treated the Kurds there, or Öcalan's peace initiative, nevertheless, we can see some movement, we can see some potential. As far as I'm concerned, Rojava is an inspiration for the rest of the world's captive nations, because obviously it succeeded. And the watchword has got to be, from Kurds, from the Kurdish struggle, is perseverance. Because eventually you will get in the right place at the right time, and you will get an opportunity to exploit those circumstances. And I believe the Kurds are doing that, and we wish them very well, and we will try and support you.
Your organization, Nations Without States, is a pressure group, as you mentioned earlier, sponsored by the National Liberal Party. How can your group be more supportive to the democratic process going on in Rojava?
Well, of course, we can lobby the media here and in the West in general. We can lobby politicians to recognize Rojava as an autonomous region and as a player in any peace negotiations, which are clearly going to take a long time to be settled. We can also try and get direct aid and support for Rojava, because I believe obviously there's problems there, economic problems, and we are trying to develop an economic side to our pressure group, like promoting small businesses, for instance, as a way of employing people in difficult areas. Also, we're looking at thinking outside the box for new initiatives. For instance, there's European elections in May in Europe, and we're going to put up a party list under the title National Liberal Party Self-Determination for All. Eight candidates standing in London, all representing different communities, including Tamil, Kashmiri, Sikh, etc. But also we will have a Kurdish representative, a Dr. Yusuf Anwar, who I actually believe is a Syrian Kurd. So in that way we can bring to the attention of Londoners and possibly a global audience that Kurds are struggling for self-determination, and particularly Rojava. So this will give lots of publicity for the Kurdish struggle and other struggles, of course. And actually, we believe we can be elected. So we'll have a voice for Kurds and everybody else in the European Parliament. So we won't have to be lobbying politicians to give you some crumbs from the table. We will be taking the table, because we'll actually be there.
Graham Williamson, member of the Executive Board of Nations Without States, you've been with us from London. Thank you very much for speaking to Rona Hee.
Thank you very much, and long live Rojava.
Thank you very much.